Chapter 16, A Mistaken Gate. I was in Tokyo, Japan, at another UFO conference when the news hit about Heaven's Gate and their spring 1997 mass suicide in San Diego. If you're like most people I know, initially you were shocked and confused and maybe a bit scared, fearing an ugly aftermath in U.S. society for all of us who care about UFO ET matters. Perhaps by now you've forgotten all this. Or perhaps you're sick and tired of hearing about Heaven's Gate and their tangled teachings. Yet the whole event and the media circus surrounding it is too important for us to pass up. In this chapter, we will focus on this particular drama, played out by some quite sincere players, special men and women who aspired to, quote, go beyond human, answering what they truly considered, quote, the last call, which are their terms. Although the Japanese newspapers gave full-page coverage to the suicide and its background, I didn't realize its magnitude until I returned to San Francisco. On my answering machine were impassioned calls from ABC News and some writers from Newsweek, Washington Post, and a Boise, Idaho newspaper, plus calls from friends and colleagues around the U.S. curious to chat about what happened. At the beginning, I had little to say, since I considered all of this just typical cult behavior, comparable to the other mass suicide we all know, the Jonestown Guyana deaths and the Jim Jones group. The actions of Heaven's Gate seem to be the result of confused psychology and blurry metaphysics. However, after reading some of their material and thinking more about it, I realized there's much more to say about this group and about the particular gate that they chose. Interestingly, a colleague and close friend of mine in San Francisco almost joined that group a few years ago, and he knew some of those who did. You may ask, what kind of person is he? Is he just a typical cult follower, disempowered and desperate for meaning, confused and longing for escape? Is he personally weak and easily duped? Actually, understanding his motives is not that easy. If we take a closer look at this friend who almost joined up, we can learn more about the magnetic pull exerted by the group and why their suicide had such a strong effect on wanderers and spiritually minded people all around the world. We may also learn something about ourselves. Like those who died in San Francisco, or San Diego, my friend also longs for a level above human and realizes the limitations of human society and the physical realm. Like spiritual seekers everywhere, he values self-purification and acknowledges an apparent cosmic struggle between good and evil, darkness and light, confusion and ignorance. He's been deeply involved in the metaphysics and meditation work for many years, studying and pondering UFO issues and ET contact. He's read the raw material quite well, and today he realizes that he's a wanderer. He's certainly no beginner on the path. You can even read his personal story in Section 3, Chapter 43, entitled Moments of Higher Awareness. With all of his apparent awareness and maturity in spiritual matters, how could he be lured by the Heaven's Gate group? Why did he nearly surrender autonomy to follow their rigid way? Of course, the answers are unique to his own life path and personality, and derive from a deep sense of alienation and aimlessness, but there's more here than just psychology. As the group itself proclaimed, they offered a gate to freedom, and although to many it was clearly a mistaken gate, the human thirst for salvation is so strong and the urgency of the present time on earth so severe that their appeal bypassed logic and the intellect. Our longing for heaven springs from the deepest levels of self, indeed from the core of self with a capital S, its very will to be. It's no exaggeration to say that the search for freedom and a gateway to heaven, however it's defined, is a primary motivation in human life. I cannot stress enough the power of such liberation theology. The soul itself longs to be expressed, to shine in fullness through personality into matter. Our deeply based needs for freedom, our longing for individualized versions of heaven, reflects no less than the soul's demand for its own self-discovery, which is the purpose of its very existence and the cosmic plan. It is for this reason that the work of evolution is sometimes called the path of return. So why do I say that theirs was a, quote, mistaken gate? The answer can be found in the shock felt by most of us upon seeing their grisly death, viewing TV images of 39 bodies neatly laid out with purple cloth atop their heads. What a waste, I thought. Simply put, suicide is not a path to heaven. despite their creative mix of apocalyptic Christianity, body-denying asceticism, and naive UFO adoration, they missed the mark. Killing the body does not open the gates to heaven. While many wanderers and seekers might agree with portions of their metaphysics, such as the existence of non-physical realms and the value of personal discipline, their rigid lifestyle was simply unbalanced. After reading some of their works, however, I do have a better picture of why they did what they did. For openers, they were basically Christians who operated out of quite ordinary Judeo-Christian beliefs. In their writings, one of which is entitled Beyond Human Session 1 and was posted on internet sites, their bias is clear. They write, in part, quote, "The Bible was the only authentic record we have of the kingdom of God's relationship with man. Jesus came in as an opportunity to restore man to God in a relationship that was pleasing to God. Satan's primary effort was to give misinformation to humans," end quote. As Christians, they were also locked into dualistic thinking. God or man, Jesus versus Satan, sin or salvation, heaven versus earth. So their approach to liberation and enlightenment was also dualistic. If their members could only, quote, "drop all the behavior that was not common to the kingdom of heaven," end quote, they imagined its gates would swing wide open. They rejected desires of the flesh, since they assumed rightly that we do not use such physical bodies in the level above human. Of course, cosmic duality is common to many mystic traditions, and asceticism is often considered a path to salvation. But in the Eastern religious systems that, at least to me, seem most highly developed, such as Buddhism, Hindu Vedanta, and Chinese Taoism, there's a much more subtle understanding layered in. They realize that the quality of our experience is determined by our perception, and so salvation depends on your state of consciousness. Practices of body denial may or may not, in and of themselves, effect the required change of awareness. In these traditions, one, the rigid line between material and spiritual worlds is considered to be an illusion. Two, our sense of suffering and separate self is held to derive from ignorance and limited perception. And three, the keys to heaven are found through the self-generated transformation of consciousness. To the mystic, the path of return does not mean physically returning to a particular place, and certainly not jumping aboard some comet-veiled UFO craft, but rather returning to a state of being which is, in reality, our own true nature. Buddhists call this, quote, state, nirvana, literally blowing out or extinguishing the flame of craving and becoming. Hindus call it Satchit Ananda, being, consciousness, bliss, while metaphysical folks may call it higher self. Whatever the name, it represents a state of conscious unity with all that is. You cannot get a better heaven than that. This teaching is one of the priceless gems given by Oriental religions, still largely unappreciated in the West. It is the notion that freedom is earned by developing awareness, not by dogmas, creeds, amulets, or good deeds, ascetic or otherwise. Going further, the foundation of this teaching is an even greater jewel, an understanding that human nature is infinite, and that the absolute creator and the true self are, in fact, one being. These ideas come from millennia of personal insight gained by yogis and seekers in meditation, and can be attained in practical realization by anyone if you take the time and make enough right effort. While they held some very ordinary Judeo-Christian beliefs, Heaven's Gate also considered UFOs to be, quote, spacecraft from the kingdom of heaven, a notion which is far more accurate than it appears. All students of fourth density esoteric history know that human ET contact in previous ages was placed in a religious mythic framework, and that many ET groups from fourth density do come to Earth in spacecraft. This higher density just so happens to be the level above human, which, according to the raw material, was indeed the home density of Jesus, the wanderer. Right on the mark, Heaven's Gate also claimed that Jesus was an ET from this level. However, they were led astray by their naive, childish trust that the internet postings claiming that Comet Hale-Bopp had a hidden UFO twin were correct, which it wasn't. For a bit of perspective, we should not overlook the fact that all such frenzied UFO talk is almost totally forgotten today. Beware of sensational claims. The Heaven's Gate group believed the craft flying shrouded in Hale-Bopp's tail would whisk them to the next level. In their one-dimensional, Christo-cosmic view, They seem to imagine that, quote, since all UFOs are from the next level, then they must be available to take us back there, end quote. This notion seems unbelievably naive and is like abandoned children longing for long-lost parents to come and rescue them. It seems also to be a variation on the theme promoted by Sheldon Neidel and his Operation Victory Group, who made grand predictions for benevolent ET mass landings in late 1996, stemming from Mr. Neidel's popular book, You Are Becoming a Galactic Human. I have heard that they continue to make such predictions, although previous ones have fallen flat and the core group has splintered. To me, this is just another example of confused psychology mixed up with blurry metaphysics. Obviously, what happened to Heaven's Gate is not an isolated event, and I think we can expect more claims, cults, sensations, and media frenzy in the future. As harvest approaches, the 3D cycle unwinds, and Earth changes heat up, I will not be surprised if the collective mass psyche spins out in a multitude of directions. Yet, we will be just fine if we keep centered. The members of Heaven's Gate, wherever they are now, and many of whom were likely wanderers, certainly deserve our sympathy and love, not scorn or contempt. They sought the eternal goal, just as we all do, the only problem being that they chose a mistaken gate. Their legacy should be a reminder to all of us about the importance of having discernment, personal balance, and essential self-trust. In the next chapter, we will take aim at their main detractors, the hungry buzzard media, which seems to relish disaster and tragedy. Just check out the latest headlines. We should have no illusions. Far from being messengers of truth, mass media is instead the prime source of both sensationalism and disinformation surrounding the UFO ET matter, and unfortunately, they are the main force shaping public opinion.